everyone. Tonight I'm going to read Envy and Jealousy by Joseph Bergot at afterpsychotherapy.com. Now, he seems to be an expert. I have his book. I just got it, and I haven't read it yet. However, all the articles I've been reading from his book, excerpts and such, and just general articles, he really knows his stuff. So, on to Envy and Jealousy. In his collection of essays on the seven deadly sins, Joseph Epstein singles out envy as the most painful of those sins to experience, with none of the ancillary pleasures that go along with, say, lust or gluttony. As I've discussed elsewhere, nobody wants to feel envious or to acknowledge feeling that way to others. Like hatred in our culture, it remains a taboo subject. It might be acceptable to admit you feel jealous that a friend has a trip planned to Europe or bought an expensive new pair of shoes. There's a good chance you could one day go on such a trip yourself or add to your own wardrobe. Jealousy is in the modern sense means I admire what you have and I wish I could have something just like that too. Jealousy is the cleaned up, socially acceptable version of envy. Almost nobody would say, I'm envious that you're better looking than I am. You can't change the way you or the other person looks. Few people would admit, I'm envious that you have a spouse and children while I haven't had a relationship in years. To admit to such feelings acknowledges a level of hatred most personal relationships cannot tolerate. For the truth is that envy, the green-eyed monster, wants to destroy what it cannot have. The solution to envy. The way to find relief from suffering its causes, if you can't have what you envy for yourself, is to make the envied object less worthy of that emotion by spoiling or destroying it. Aesop's fable about the fox and the grapes speaks of unbearable desire, but also describes a psychic mechanism, spoiling, active when envy comes into play. Another way to cope with envy in fantasy is simply to become the object of envy or take possession of it, as I described in my last point on merger fantasies. Once my client Jim and I understood the nature of those fantasies of merger, and he started to separate from his idealized view of me, he began to feel intense envy. Instead of dreams where my beautiful wife and I gave glamorous parties in a glamorous home, now Jim brought in dreams where that home was destroyed by an earthquake or fire. In those dreams, his envy hid behind an apparently heartfelt concern for my loss, but as I pointed out to him, it was his dream. He was the one who had destroyed my house, even if he seemed to feel sorry for me afterward. In the school of thought in which I was trained, envy plays an important role in many forms of mental illness. I learned that when you uncovered envy, you had reached bedrock. Over the years since I finished my formal schooling, I've come to think differently. Now I believe that while envy is an inescapable part of the human experience, if you've had a good enough upbringing without too much damage, it's manageable more in the realm of jealousy, as discussed above. When things go seriously awry, leaving a residue of basic shame, envy becomes intolerable. In that case, the recognition that someone has attributes or relationships that you don't and might never have puts you in touch with unbearable shame. To make matters worse, people who feel such irreparable damage usually long for magical and ideal solutions to their difficulties. As a result, they tend to idealize the person they envy, which further inflames that emotion. It's a poisonous brew, toxic to the person who feels it, and lethal for his or her relationships. I'll give a personal example from many years ago, one about which I still feel ashamed. At a dinner party at my home attended by several friends, including a successful writer who I very much envied as an aspiring writer myself, this writer mentioned a comment someone had recently made to her about her having psychological and emotional issues with men, especially men in positions of authority. She said she didn't understand why that person would tell her such a thing, as she didn't believe there was any truth in it. I said, I disagree. I think you have major issues with men. She did. It was true. And what I said was extremely hurtful, especially given that I'm a therapist and when I offer such opinions, it carries some weight. On an unconscious level, I intended it to hurt, though I didn't recognize it at the time, an expression of my envy for her. This was the second remark I discussed in my post about the art of apology. In due course, I apologized, but the damage was done. Our friendship never recovered. Finding your own way. Have you ever damaged a relationship in the way that I did? Try to discover if envy motivated you. See if you can't admit what you envy about the person. Do you justify yourself in your actions? Try to make it seem as if the person deserved what you did or that it really was no big deal. Whom do you envy now? Envy plays a large role in many people's attitudes towards celebrities, as I discussed in an earlier post. I wasn't surprised to hear the justification people gave for Ricky Gervais' cruel humor at the Golden Globe Awards. In a discussion forum I visited, many readers said that they believed the injured celebrities should stop whining, that they had set themselves up so high and mighty and deserved to be brought down to size. To me, this is envy talking. Do you envy rich and famous people and wish them ill? When you read about their misfortunes on the covers of supermarket tabloids, do you feel a small thrill of glee? What about your friends? Is there one among them who seems to have so much more than you do? How do you feel about that person? Have you ever secretly rejoiced when something bad happened to him or her? Most likely. It was the emotion of envy rearing its ugly green-eyed head. Envious. Have I ever been? I recall once as a teenager being very, very depressed and having awful thoughts about how I could manipulate my way into a situation and take what somebody had. Yes, I admit it. And then I thought, God, that can't be normal. That can't be healthy. That can't be right. I scared myself, actually, because I was in a dark place when I was thinking those thoughts. And I swore I'd never do it again, and I haven't. It's a hard place to imagine, but that's where your narcissist lives. Pathological envy. They steal identities. They mimic people that they want to be like. They get away with it. Because they want something from you. Money, a foot in the door, credibility, reputation, you name it. My narc condo neighbor was the single white female. My malignant narcissist played on that. Things have come to light present day that she actually did steal my identity. She's actually emulating me. I recall times when I lived next to her that, gee, I would get a pair of sunglasses, and the next week she would get the same pair of sunglasses. I painted my kitchen cabinets, and she painted hers shortly after. I would get the expensive hand cream that was just a treat. I don't usually do that for myself, and the next thing you know, it's sitting on her kitchen table. And then there's my daughter. She had free access to my daughter via Facebook. And don't think for a second the malignant narcissist that I was married to took advantage of that envy. Because I recall many times him saying, you know, our condo neighbor did this, our condo neighbor did that. Well, honey, you can't really compare me and the fat slob, our condo neighbor. But he did. He'd try. I could see him looking for my reaction. Like, you want me to be jealous? Not a chance in fucking hell. No, but things have come to light. She's actually sort of pretending to be me. Yeah. And the malignant narcissist, of course, he's gonna feed that jealousy, that envy. It doesn't work with me. I don't get jealous. Not really. No. If I am, I'll say so. But I'm usually not. No, envy doesn't work with me. But apparently, it works with some people. Very much so. Yeah. So imagine being married to a malignant narcissist, having had a malignant narcissist as a neighbor. I didn't see this. I mean, I saw it, but I thought, well, no big deal. Oh, it was a big deal. It was a very big deal. Because when the two of them got working together, they nearly destroyed me. Nearly. But I figured it out. See, they've been getting away with it for so fucking long. I never thought anyone would figure it out, did they? Yeah. But I did. Once again, proving how much better I am than you. How much more exceptional I am than you. You can never be me. Ever. Because you're you. Pathetic. I hope that helps someone tonight. Peace out.